Hey YouTubers, it's me, Lonnie Clark, and that's for art. Of course, you know that because you came here. Anyways, I'm going to read more. I was going to go to bed. It's late tonight. It's Friday night, but I know I haven't read, so it does weigh on my heart. If I go a few days without reading, please forgive me, but like the last 5 days, I had just somebody just drop in and be at my house who didn't contribute to the housework at all. So, anyways, let me get on to the reading. We're continuing reading Human Radiation Studies, Remembering the Early Years, Oral History of Dr. John W. Gofman, MD, PhD, conducted December 20th, 1994, United States Department of Energy, Office of Human Radiation Experiments. Office of Human Radiation Experiments. Let's say that one more time. United States Department of Energy. United States Department of Energy. The United States, our United States Department of Energy created this office. Office of Human Radiation Experiments. We need to experiment on people, folks. Office of Human Radiation Experiments, June 1995. So I just want to let that sink in. I can't get over the information that we're reading here. So let me get on with it. I'm going to pick up from the very last paragraph that he said, not the one where we were off at, but I want to go to the top one because this is to the point and we'll make this video more succinct. Now there is a peculiarity about this. It's interesting how people's minds can be compartmentalized. Let me illustrate that. When 1946 broke on the scene, we had the Atomic Energy Commission set up and in operation January 1, 1947, 57, 67, 77, 87, 97, 2007, 2017. How many years is that, boys and girls? 70 years. They're still fucking up. Okay, let me just, sorry about that. And in operation January 1, 1947. I, like Shields Warren, by the way, thought very highly of him. I like Shields Warren, by the way. Who is Shields Warren? I have no idea. Do you think I remember that from the last time? Heck no. A question comes up. Well, what are you saying? Are you telling me that no radiation was harmful? Yes, they did know it was harmful, but in a crazy way. In the 1920s, there was these women who were tipping their brushes with their tongues, painting the watch dials with radium. And they got the most horrific bone necrosis and cancer of the bones, sarcomas. Most horrific. It's not like you just get bone cancer and you're okay. Harrison Martland wrote that Harrison Martland wrote that up in 1928, so everybody in the medical world knew about this. So this was the doctor who studied this. In the 1920s, there were these women who were tipping their brushes with their tongues. Oh, I see. I guess they were dipping it and holding it, painting the watch dials with radium, and they got the most horrific bone necrosis and cancer of the bone, sarcomas. Harrison Martland wrote this up in 1928, so everybody in the medical world knew about it. Moreover, in two places in Europe where they mine silver and other metals, also rich in uranium. Oh, okay. So that's a little factoid. Mining silver and other metals rich in, so silver is rich in uranium. One was in Germany and one was in Czechoslovakia. There had been a disease known for about 300 years called mountain sickness. Wow, what a clever name. Turned out that in 1879 it was discovered that mountain sickness was lung cancer. Who'd have guessed? In the 1920s and 30s, it was pretty well settled that alpha particles from radon and the daughters of radon were the cause of that lung cancer. The interesting thing, the interesting thing, I don't know how about you guys, but the callousness of American medical doctors is just beyond belief. Let's repeat the title of this Office of Human Radiation Experiments. Okay, let's go back to this. The interesting thing was somehow all these radiologists didn't relate the external use of gamma rays and X-rays. The gamma rays from radium and the X-rays to these internal things caused by alpha particles. Let me read that again. I don't think I got the full sentence. The gamma rays from radium and the X-rays to these external things caused by alpha particles. It was all radiation, but somehow they separated one from the other in their minds. Alternative facts. Here we go again. So I understand, although it was part of a terrible misuse of the technology, doing whatever you want to do on anything new and not thinking about the long-term consequences, somehow they never just related these two things. It's called sociopathy or psychopathy or I don't know, being a sick mental fuck who uses people as human radiation experiments. You had the whole scene dominated by people who'd come through radiology. You know, if somebody in Tennessee gave somebody something, some iron experiments or calcium experiments, I can see these people saying, hey, look, what are you making a fuss about? We used to give people 200 from the thymus in the chest. Oh, yeah, don't worry. We used to fucking kill off kids all the time. Don't worry about it, folks. I think if Rush Faden doesn't understand that, she's not going to understand the whole story. The story doesn't start in 1945. What started in 1945, however, was a different thing. That was arrogance. That started in 1945. They could kill all the babies in the early of the part of the century with radiation, but that wasn't arrogance. That was just they just didn't know. I haven't got a good thing to say about the Atomic Energy Commission at all. But for very distinct reasons, I don't mind. I don't want to go into that and not answer questions if you have in your, excuse me. But for very distinct reasons, I don't want to go into that and not answer the questions you have in your mind. Gourley, I don't know whether we should continue chronology or Gofman. I was just going to say, I am not an anti-bomber, so I'm in trouble. Anti-bomber. I am not an anti-bomber, so I'm in trouble. The Department of Energy officially hates me. The nuclear industry hates me. And a good segment of the disarmament movement, because I'm not a disarmer. Oh, wow. Okay, folks, hold on. Salut. Uh-oh, I left my water in the other room. Okay, so I guess in those days, if you didn't want atomic weapons, you had to want regular weapons. Like, how about no weapons, folks? How about we just say, we got the weapons, but we're not building anymore because we can, you know, we got it. Okay. Gourley. Okay, so I don't know. Okay, so we're about out at him, the pity party. Because I'm not a disarmer. People asked, what's Gofman's hidden agenda? The trouble is, I don't have one. The last thing is my hidden agenda is to get rid of nuclear weapons because I'm a bigger supporter of nuclear weapons than anybody in the Department of Energy that I know. Really, I think they're important. They just think that they're a continuation of bureaucracy. But I just wanted to say that you'll hear bad things about me, such as Gofman thinks nuclear deterrence is important. And I do. I don't favor giving up our bombs. It's a real mix-up picture. The heck are you talking about? I'm going to go back and read that. I think that fucking line got to my head. Okay. Gofman. I was just going to say I'm not an anti-bomber, so I'm in trouble. The Department of Energy officially hates me. The nuclear industry hates me. And a good segment of the disarmament movement, because I'm not a disarmer. People talked. What's Gofman's hidden agenda? The trouble is, I don't have one. The last thing is that my hidden agenda is to get rid of nuclear weapons. Because I'm a bigger supporter of nuclear weapons than anybody in the Department of Energy that I know. I really think they're important. They just think that they're a continuation of bureaucracy. But I just wanted to say that you'll hear bad things of me, such as Gofman thinks nuclear deterrence is important. And I do. I don't favor giving up our bombs. It's a real mix-up picture. So this is weird. Okay, it just hit me like a ton of bricks. You see how they make, all of a sudden, they cut into something else? This is the fucking United States government cutting out like what he just said, and let's go into something else. So here's Gourley. Establishing Livermore Laboratories Division of Biology and Medicine, 1962. Gourley. Should we follow through with that or go to Livermore? Let's go on to Livermore. What brought you to Livermore and to the Biology Division in Medicine there? BDM. That kind of reminds me of like now, right? I think it's not, this is DBM, but I think it's BDM now. What? Divest, boycott, divest, and I don't know. Divest, I don't know. I forget what it is. Well, I'm going to get back to this. Sorry, you guys. Should we follow through with that or go to Livermore? Let's get on to Livermore. What brought you to Livermore and the Division of Biology and Medicine there? Gofman. Well, in 1953, after the Livermore lab was established, Ernest Lawrence called me up to his office and said, Jack, you're the only person in Rad Lab family that is both a chemist and a physician. I'm afraid that the 100 or so guys who have gone from Berkeley to Livermore, Herb, York, and the others who set it up, are going to hurt themselves. I don't know if you know about it, but Ernest is an absolute bear on safety in the lab. He believed in it. He said, if you go out there a couple of days a week as my personal representative, nose around everything. If you don't like what you see, tell them how to change it. And there's no use going to anybody else because you're speaking for Ernest Lawrence. So I said, sure, I'll go there. So he got authority from Ernest Lawrence. I want it done. Gourley, what sort of things were you looking for? Yeah, what did you want? Gofman, mishandling of hot materials from Nevada without adequate protection. This is almost a joke after they fucking nucleated the entire goddamn planet. Oh my god. Okay, let's just keep reading. Mishandling of hot materials from Nevada without adequate protection. Not wearing film badges while doing things. All violations of radiation safety, and there were many. So starting in 1953 and early 54, I went out to Livermore a couple of days a week. In order to hang my hat, I decided I'd organize the Industrial Medical Department. I became the medical director of Livermore Industrial Medicine, not research. So in all the new examinations, new hires, people leaving or whatever, going out to the Pacific for a test, all the exams before and after all came through me. But that was just a place to hang my hat. What I'd do was go around to see what the physicists were doing, or the chemists, or somebody was handling some hot material without their film badge. I'd say, "Where is your film badge?" And they'd say, "Over in the drawer in the other building." And I'd say, "Why?" And they'd say, "I can't get the job done if I'm wearing the film badge. I'll get overexposed." So I had to raise hell with them. What the fuck? He had to raise hell with them because they didn't want to get overexposed. What a fuck. Excuse my language. At any rate, in the course of that, there are a lot of questions that came up among the weaponers. The weaponers. Wow. I got to know them. Gourley. What were some of the questions? Gofman. Oh, you know, people were criticizing them about the carbon-14 and about tritium-37, and that they were releasing during the test. Was it really that bad? And so I would help them with calculations, including John Foster, who was in the weapons division. So I got to know all the weaponers, such as Herb York. Gourley, you mean Teller? Gofman, oh sure, I knew him too. I knew him a lot more later, but that wasn't my research function at Livermore. I brought Max Biggs, who had gotten his Ph.D. with me and was assistant director of medicine there. I did it until 1957, at which time Max took over completely, and I didn't go out to Livermore anymore after 1957. Then things moved up to 1962. John Foster had become the director of Livermore Lab, and I knew him from the earlier days when I helped him. He called me up one day and said, "Will you come out here to see me?" So I did. "We have a peculiar request. We got a request from the Atomic Energy Commission to see if we would set up a biomedical research division here at Livermore." He said, "What do you think of the idea?" I said, "Biomedical division at Livermore." I said, "The AEC's got 18 or 19 labs already. Why a biomedical division at Livermore?" Because people were dropping off like flies, probably. He said, "Well, they don't say it, but I know what the reason is. We had this huge series of tests in Nevada." By the way, when Khrushchev broke the voluntary moratorium on testing, President John Kennedy gave the labs an order, put on a spectacular show. That was just one, and they did. But the trouble was that the milk network was by then in 62, much more in place, and Utah was getting clobbered with radioiodine. Of course, it became a real flap in Utah, and of course, the Federal Radiation Council solved it by announcing that the safe level of radioiodine in milk was 3 times higher than they previously thought. Well, at least they only did it 3 times, unlike Obama, who did it like, 100,000 times. They just took care of it. John Foster said that the commissioners were getting flack thrown at them from all over, and they were on the hot seat. Gourley, where was that flack coming from? Gofman, Utah downwinders. So I said, they're getting a lot of flack from Utah. What in the world has that got to do with setting up a biomedical division in Livermore? He said, some of the commissioners feel that if we, who are making the bombs and setting them off in Nevada, had some biomedical advice, maybe they wouldn't get caught flat-footed with these things in the scandal in Utah. And I said, but Johnny, what are you going to do if you start a biomedical division and you set off bombs in Utah? Could a biomedical division prevent fallout from coming down? I said, it's crazy. You can't do it. He said, well, There aren't some things you can't do, and we talked about it. I agreed that one of the things that could be done was to examine all the new bombs and look at them. If you got iron in this position, it gets a hell of a lot of neutrons in radiation. Couldn't it be better if you substituted aluminum or something like that? You might thereby cut down on the amount of fallout that would occur in some of these test bombs. And I said, a biomedical division isn't going to stop the problem of fallout, except in maybe making it less. So Johnny said, do you think fallout is important? And I said, yes. The cancer and genetic effects of the fallout are very important. Aside from heart disease, it is the most important problem in medicine as I look at things. Gourley, you are basing your opinion then on what? Gofman, the fallout. The fallout? Yes. Gofman, yes. There was enough evidence to be very worried about the fallout. Linus Pauling had made calculations that indicated that we might have caused a lot of potential cancers and genetic defects for what had already been done in the worldwide testing. In 1956 and 58, Alice Stewart had written on the fact that just about a half a rad to a rad received by children in utero was to give a big excess, a 50% increase of cancer in the first 10 years of life. How many people's children in St. Louis have died at 7, 8, 9, 10? Way too fucking many. So a lot of things were coming up. And I said, Johnny, the way I live my life is I decided to work on big medical problems. And as I don't understand any other than that, I am not going to work on heart disease then. I want to work on cancer and genetic injuries because those are the big things that kill people by the millions prematurely. Gourley, yes. Now, the State Department is concurring with Dr. John Gofman that it causes death by the millions. Get that statement. Hold on. Okay. As I don't understand any other than that, if I'm not going to work on heart disease, then I want to work on cancer and genetic injuries. Because those are the big things that kill people by the millions prematurely. Gourley says, yes. Jack, all we want is the truth. That's in quotes. That's a subtitle. Gofman says, so you know, you think fallout is important? I said, yes, it's important. He said, how would you like to come out here and build this biomedical lab? And I said, no way, no way. I said, I don't trust the Atomic Energy Commission. Look at what they did to Linus Pauling. Look at the criticism they leveled at Alice Stewart. Gourley, even then? Gofman, yes, even then. I said, I don't trust them. Foster said, do you trust me? I said, I've known you for quite a while, Johnny. He said, I'm never going to Washington like Harold Brown did. He said, I'm going to stay here at this lab because I think it's where the most action is. So he says, I can tell you one thing. If you came out here, you'd have my absolute backing. I said, that'd be nice to have. He said, do you trust the regents of the University of California? Oh, dear. He should have said no. I said, Johnny, I have very good relations with the regents of the University of California. I have very staunch friends. I do trust them. He said, do you know Clark Kerr? I said, of course I know Clark. He's the president of the university, and I have a lot of respect for Clark. He said, supposing I could get you a letter from the regents and from Clark Kerr that if you came out here to head this thing and if you were ever unhappy about it, you could go back full time to your professorship, no questions asked. I said, well, I certainly wouldn't give up my professorship, but I could cut down my time, and I don't think, I certainly wouldn't give up my professorship, but I could cut down my time, but I don't think it's for me. I'm happy at Berkeley. I've just gotten through the early years of having 50 or 60 people working with me. I'm back in the lab working myself, physically working, not administering to a group of 60. Why would I want to do that? He said, well, fallout's important. How would you like to work on problems like that? Build your own staff, all the people you want to bring in. You'll have the best facilities in the world. Livermore does indeed have the best facilities. They'll build you a building, Foster said, and indeed they did. Oh my gosh, I think I just saw 25 up there. Let me see. Oy, it's 26. Okay, so I'm going to stop, but let me mark it. So this is the thing, folks. I'm going to keep coming back to read this. It's actually shocking to see John Gofman saying that he did not trust these people. Wow. Oh, well, I'm going to read it a little bit. We just stopped here. Okay. Well, I don't think we have a choice but to put our courage feet on, so maybe they're already on, man. We can't take them off. Ciao, you guys.